I will address the topic of multi-agent systems in power and energy. And this session is mostly supported by MASH Society Project. I'm quite happy to be coordinating this project. It has now 2 years of duration, so we have 1 more year to go. Mostly because the projects are at the beginning just one idea in our brain, and then it comes to the proposal, and then when it is approved, we can make it really happen in practice. And this is very good in this case because we really have a great team in MASH Society. I make an effort not to name them because if I name them, I will get enthusiastic about the topics, and I don't have the time for that today. But we hope to organize some other sessions in which we will go through other topics of the project with these people in the team. So today I will begin with the Energy Union. This is because we are not just in the European Union, we are also in the Energy Union, because energy is one of the priorities of the European Union. And the vision of the EU is to have a climate-neutral Europe by 2050, which is a very, very ambitious goal if we consider everything that is going on and we consider the current figures regarding energy and CO2 emissions. It's very important to keep in mind the package, the clean energy package for all Europeans. In fact, this is a different approach to the energy policy. It's still very ambitious and with a lot of targets which are very, very concrete. So we keep in mind this European Green Deal. Of course, this is linked to the Paris Agreement. EU and its member states are active members in signing this agreement. And the main 2 ideas of the current policy is to boost the efficient use of resources by moving to a clean and circular economy, and also to restore the biodiversity and cut pollution. Easy to say, much more difficult to do, of course. And then we can look at more concrete figures. We have very concrete targets for 2030. We can go to the next slide. And when we see that the target is, for instance, to cut 40% in greenhouse gas emission when compared to the 1990 levels, we want 32% share for renewables, and we want at least 32.5% improvement in energy efficiency. This is quite difficult. And on top of this, we want a market-driven approach. We want an approach in which every player and every distributed resource can participate and can contribute to the overall efficiency of the system. So really we have to change a lot of things in the way that power and energy systems are planned and operated. So let us see just one example. I'm taking here the example of demand response. Demand response is quite important because it brings consumers, electric energy consumers, to the center of the energy system. If we can somehow provide some flexibility in our consumption, we can actively contribute to a more efficient energy system. This is demand response because we are replying to the interest of someone else. And we can see in the right side of this slide a map of Europe. It has colors, and colors, of course, have meanings. And here the green color is the good one. So when you see the green countries, these are the most active countries when it regards demand response. Then you have yellow, they are not so good. You have red, which are really close, it's still almost close to demand response. And the countries in gray, including Portugal, they were not assessed at this time. And in fact, when it comes to Portugal, we are quite late when it comes to the actual use of demand response. Demand response is in fact very important to accomplish the goals of the energy policy that I mentioned before, because it goes very well with renewables. We have a lot of problems with renewable-based generation, because of course I cannot control the sun or the wind, so it's very difficult because it is a rigid production. But I can now have some flexibility on the side of demand and use demand response for that to cope with the management of production and consumption together. On the left-hand side of the slide, you see some comparison between several parts of the world, and you see that Europe is not in a good position when it regards to demand response, so we have a lot to do and we have a long way to go. And this brings us to AI. Artificial intelligence, as we see it, can be the basis, should be the basis of intelligent systems. So in our group, we are of course using AI techniques for a long time. And in the case of my work, I've been using it for power and energy applications. If you consider this circle, this blue circle, it represents the whole power and energy systems works. And we have here several techniques in the AI field. And the idea is that if the name of the technique is somehow outside the circle, it means that it is not considered, almost not considered in power and energy. If this term is inside the circle, it's quite used in the power and energy field. So we can look and see that machine learning, knowledge discovery, optimization and computational intelligence are techniques that are really used in power and energy systems. They are used by a lot of people, they are used all around the world, so we have a good applications for those techniques. But when we come to the other techniques that you can see in this image, in fact their use in power and energy is almost non-existent, or is just emerging, or is just for some experimentation and not actually for real-world problems. And in fact, we are working in several of these techniques that are not being right now very used in power and energy systems, namely in the Mars Society project, because we think they are really useful and they are very important to make power and energy systems, intelligent systems. Of course, we have been doing this not only in Mars Society, but in a set of projects a long time and currently. So I have here just a set of those projects that have been using these techniques in the power and energy field. And of course, also we need funding for these projects and we need partnerships. Partnerships are quite important because we must partner with the people that have the possibility to complement our work with the companies that have real problems in the field that we can use to test our advancements. So we have partnered with more than 100 companies in more than 12 countries, and that's why we have this broad vision of power and energy, and on the application of AI to these complex power and energy problems. Okay, so let's advance now, and I'll show you some aspects of what we have been working on and about the results we have regarding our approach on multi-agent based systems for power and energy. First of all, I would like to present to you this infrastructure. We call it Martin. Martin is in fact a multi-agent based real-time infrastructure for energy. And I would say that it has four levels. If we look at the button level, this is the level for real-time simulation. I'm not talking here about our real-time simulation algorithms. I'm mostly talking about our tools for real-time simulation that include hardware and software, hardware in the loop to make this simulation in real time. As a lot of you may know, the simulation of power and energy in real time is very difficult, so usually we do it with these professional tools because it is not possible to ensure real time simulation with traditional algorithms, software algorithms. Then in the next level, I have, let us say, the physical part of the system, the real world. I have the buildings, I have the electrical grid, I have all the electric appliances, and of course I have all the gateways that are needed to ensure the real-time acquisition of data and also the real-time control of the components and of the system. And then on top of that, I have the level of multi-agent systems. So the multi-agent systems we have developed are concentrated in this level. And the top level of this infrastructure is for all the intelligent applications and services. And these applications and services are the ones that we have developed, are the ones that we are testing, and maybe some of these ones are not just the ones that we have developed, but are also some of our partners' contributions that we can test using this infrastructure. More on the conceptual way, I will show you the next diagram, which is for multi-agent simulation. I divide here in green the electricity market part, so on the side of the economic operation of the system, and the blue side, which is mostly the smart grid, as we call it, the smart grid part of the system. Of course, in the market and in the smart grid, we have to consider all the involved players, and we must take into account that today we have a huge number of players in this field because we have distributed resources, because consumers can have an active role. In fact, we have a huge number of participants in these systems. That's why multi-agents are very good to model today's power and energy systems and electricity markets. Also because they can model each player in particular. Of course, if I look at a wind farm, they have things in common. If I look at electric energy consumers, they have things in common. But then I should model the concrete and particular features of each player. So this is a very good field of application for multi-agent systems. And on the right side, I have several resources, namely, I have demand response, I have optimization, I have the contracts, I have the context, because it's very important to consider the context. As common sense, we know that what we should do highly depends on the context in our daily lives. And of course, in power and energy systems, it is no different. So we should consider the context to make the correct actions and to take the correct decisions. And in the button of the right button of this slide, we have something that it is quite important for our goals, namely making these systems to operate in real time. So we have learning, of course, because we have data, we have historic data, and we use the historic data to learn. We have real-time data, and we use it to operate the system and the components of the system in real time. We consider the context, as I was telling you, and also we have the possibility of solving each of the problems with different approaches. And that's why here I have several algorithms. The meaning here is that each one of these algorithms will help me to solve one particular problem. So I have several alternatives for solving one particular problem. And of course, if I have a real-time system, I have to ensure some kind of efficiency. It is very important that the solution is good, that I am happy with the quality of the solution, but also it is very, very important that I cope with real-time constraints. So that's why I should make a balance between efficiency and the quality of the solution. And this is this 2E module, which makes this balance. So if I have more time, I can use an algorithm which takes more time and gives me a better solution. If I have less time, I have to take a compromise. I have to deliver a solution which is not so good, but will cope with my real-time constraints. Then I can show you the physical part of this. Is based on a set of equipment. We can go to the next slide for you to see some photos of these equipment. They are installed in one of the buildings of ISAP. It is much nicer in photo actually than in reality. It's not a new building, it's not a building with very good conditions when it comes to comfort and space, because our team is quite large and its space is quite small. But in fact, this is a good building, a very good building for experimentation. Why? Because we can change a lot of things in this building, and we are always making changes because we want to experiment new algorithms, new solutions, new equipment, and so on. So this is a photo which groups some of the photos of the equipment. Mostly we buy equipment that is used in actual installation. So this is not mostly lab equipment, but equipment which is used in daily use of electrical installations. And then we adapt this equipment and we make it controllable by our software. So the equipment we have in the building is controlled by our algorithms, and that's in this way we can experiment our solutions and our AI-based solutions. Right. So now let's see what is the diagram, the conceptual diagram for MASH Society. MASH Society stands for Society of Multi-Agent Systems, because a single multi-agent system is not enough to attain our purposes. And in fact, in most applications, we need several multi-agent systems. So MASH Society project focus on using several multi-agent systems all together to attain our goals. You have some examples here. You have ADEM, which is adaptive decision support for electricity market negotiations. MASHEM, which is for electricity market simulation. You have MASGRIP for simulation of smart grids. Then we have IDESMAS, which is for intelligence and decision support in general. And we have PLCMAS, which is an example of a multi-agent system, which makes the frontier with the physical part of the installation. That's why it's called PLC, coming from programmable logic control. We are also using ontologies for this, because in fact we are changing a lot the algorithms and the equipment. It became very difficult, it became very time consuming to ensure all these changes. To make our experiments, we would consume a lot of time making changes, and then of course we have the time for the experiments. And some years ago we started working on ontologies, first of all for simulation, to use on simulation of electricity markets, but more recently we are looking at ontologies and developing ontologies and semantic, mostly for operational purposes. So we are using ontologies really to cope with these requirements of the components and of the systems to understand each other. They all talk different languages, but they should all be able to understand the same concepts, even if these concepts are written or said in different ways and using different languages. This is our goal for development of ontologies, and in MASH Society projects, we are quite advancing on that field. Of course, we feed this system with real-time data, with historic data, and also we ensure the connection of our internal systems with the external one. And this is why this platform is a very good platform that we have been using in several projects, because it copes with this connection with remote systems. We can even use real-time data from outside and control outside installations, making all the management inside our labs. Okay, so we can go to the next slide. The next slide, I won't spend much time on it. It's an example of one of these systems. In this particular case, it's about ADEM. So here again, you can see Albits, for instance, in the left part, you can see Albits, which use this balancing mechanism that ensures the efficiency of the system. You can see the use of reinforcement learning to conclude what is the best approach for each of the contests that are being faced. And you can see the connection of this multi-agent system, which is a system for decision support, with the other multi-agent systems for electricity market simulation. Some of the advancements of this work are being used in Domino's project, which is a H2020 project, mainly dedicated to the use of demand response in local and electricity markets and considering the distribution system operators. Then we can see another infrastructure which is really interesting and which is really useful for our work. This is TUC. TUC stands for Tools Control Center, and also we developed it, we conceived it and we developed it as a means to ease our work. It's a means to support us in the preparation of all our experimentation. You have here all the agents and all the multi-agent systems that we use. Also in yellow, we have all the resources for optimization for contracts, as I have shown you before. And on the left part, you have all the model definition and the inputs and the models that we are using in each particular experimentation. So we can prepare this experimentation in advance and then we play them. So that's the playability, which is quite interesting. And then when the experimentation ends, it depends, some hours later, some days, some weeks later, we can have the results. We have some tools for comparing and for analyzing these results. Okay, and before going to the most practical part of my talk, I'd like to show you the next photos. Because in a way, I believe that these photos can show what is the result of our daily work. These are some photos showing different meetings and different events in our labs. And the quote here, the sentence that I have in the middle, is a quote from a colleague that knew already us for a long time from conferences, from working group meetings, from papers, but never visited our lab. And once he was, I believe, 1 year ago, he was, or 2 years ago, I'm not sure, he was invited to come to Lisbon. And he told me I'd been invited to come to Lisbon, but I want to go to visit your lab. And I told him, okay, it's 300 kilometers away, but we can arrange that. And then he came to visit us, and when he visited and saw our equipment and the things that we are arranging and all the experiments, he said, this, what a joy it must be to come here to work every day. Okay, we are not doing it right now because, you know, COVID-19 is not allowing so many people to be around in such a small space, but in fact, it was a very nice sentence, and I think that is a good sentence to have in mind when we are working and trying to accomplish our goals. Right, so now I will try to show you a concrete application of our models. So these multi-agent based models, of course, they have inside learning features, they have inside optimization features. And what I will show you is an example of the use of this system in a real application. Of course, here I have slides. I don't have the actual installation, but this is the result of running the system for online management. So we are talking about real-time management of the actual electric appliances, which are decided in sequence of the decisions taken by our algorithms. I'm mostly talking here not about decision support, but about automated actions. So I know that artificial intelligence main goal now and mainly in the early years of AI was decision support with the human in the loop. And having the human in the loop is really important. Consider the human when it comes to decisions and critical decisions is very important. But the actual reality is that most of the critical processes and decisions cannot cope with the timings that humans need to solve them and to take the good decisions. So what we should do in practice is to figure out what is the knowledge that is important to take the decisions, to model that knowledge, to use it inside our systems, and then to make it to be used automatically. And of course, we must come back to it. We must analyze the results and the outcomes. We must discuss these results. And maybe we must change something on the way. But mostly, we are developing automated systems, AI systems based on data and knowledge, not just data, but they are fully automated. So here I am considering an aggregator. And maybe I say some words about aggregators. They are really, really important to accomplish the goals of current power and energy systems, because these distributed resources that I mentioned before, these are small-scale resources, medium-scale resources, and most of them don't have the knowledge or the means to participate in the smart grid and to participate in the required actions, for instance, to provide demand response to the grid. So aggregators are very important because they can be the key to open the box that has inside all this demand flexibility that can then be provided to the system through the aggregator. It would never have been possible to provide this flexibility if this aggregation was not used. Anyway, the aggregator is independent from the resources. The aggregator is independent from the grid. We are in a market-driven approach, don't forget that. So each one of the players is deciding on itself. So here we have the grid, of course, we have the aggregator, we have some resources that are relying on this aggregator to participate, for instance, in the market, to participate in demand response events. This does not mean that they are not taking their own decisions. If they had the means to take decisions, they will do that. Of course, if they don't have the means, they will make the aggregator to act on their behalf. Okay, so we can maybe go to the next slide. And in the next slide, I have the same picture, but larger, so I can show you that in fact, this aggregator is looking at the context. Again, the context is very important. So he is looking at everything and he is trying to figure out what is the best possible use of the actual resources, energy resources, for that particular context. And the result is on the top right of the slide. He decided that this resource scheduling was the best solution for his problem. Okay, so we go to the next slide and we see that this aggregator has communicated is a solution to the resources. For instance, he has told this consumer that this would be the best solution. But the best solution for the system does not mean the best solution for each consumer. So depending on the intelligence of this consumer, maybe you will come out with a different solution and with a different decision. Then we use ontologies, as I told you before, because we have to put all these players through their equipment and through their hardware talking together, all this in real time. So we use the ontologies for this. And then I show you the network we are considering. This network does not exist in our lab, of course. This part is simulated, but is realistically simulated, but all the other things are real. Namely, you can see in different colors these loads. These are real-time monitored loads, so everything is going on in real time. load for the green one comes from a residential consumer. Load one comes from our lab building, and load six in red, it's what we call our smart home lab. I will explain a little bit later better what this is. So we can go to the next slide. The next slide shows you the scheduling that the aggregator believes is the best solution for this context. On side of generation, of course, we have the electrical energy generation, but we can also consider as generation in a broad sense, storage, discharge, and demand response, because if we consider that demand response in this case corresponds to cutting some demand, in fact, it's the same to cut demand as to put more generation in system. And when it comes to consumption in the broad sense, we can talk about the sales of energy, the charging of storage units, and also of the actual load. And in the next slide, we have another diagram. This diagram is for load four, and you can see in this diagram, for instance, in blue you see the consumption, in yellow you see the demand response, and then you have three different lines, which are dark blue, red, and green, and these are all consumption forecasts. But they are different, of course. They are different because the first one is a day-ahead forecast. Then you have the blue one, which is an hour-ahead forecast. And finally, you have in red the real-time forecast. This is reality. So, in fact, all these forecast methods must be used in relation with the anticipation they are being used. And of course, in the day ahead, we don't have the same data as we have 1 hour ahead or in real time. So they are different and they have different results. Hopefully, the real-time forecast is very, very close to the actual consumption because the actual real-time management relies on that forecast. Okay, this is the same diagram for load one, our building. And then we can see also for this building, the next slide, we can see scheduling for each one of the appliances in the building. So here you have appliance by appliance. And you see this is for 24 hours, 5 minutes, minute by minute. You can see each of the appliances, what is the consumption in that moment. You have, of course, the air conditioning, you have sockets, you have lights, and every one of them is here with a very concrete value for each moment. So, next slide, we can look at load number six. Load number six is what we call our smart home lab, sorry. In fact, it's not a home, of course, but we have almost all the appliances that could be in a home. So we arrange them as if they were in the rooms of a real home. So it's a real home in the sense that we have the real appliances. It's not a real home in the sense that we don't have a living room or a bedroom, but we have a kitchen, for instance, and we have some places with a round table that could be the living room of the houses. So in this diagram, you have the consumption and demand response. Again, forecasts for day ahead, hour ahead, and real time. And in the next slide, I show you the actual consumption for each of the appliances. So you see on the right a plant. The button right is the virtual smart home. And all the appliances in this plant are appliances that are considered in this scheduling. Most of them are real appliances that we have in our building. So we have a kettle, that's true. We have a microwave. We have a coffee maker. We have lights. We have TV sets. We have a fridge. So we have most of these. And what is interesting to consider is that when you see here along the day the consumption of each of these loads, the actual system will control the load in real time, and this is the outcome of this control. So the control, the decision and control is done in real time, and this is the output of the actual consumption already decided in function of the context along the day. Okay, so I'm almost finishing. Just I wanted to refer an additional topic. You see that we are using a lot of data. In fact, we have in our repositories lots and lots of data. And data is very important. And mostly real data, because when we use generated data, it's always very different. It's very important that we can have real data. Real data is never perfect, as real life is never perfect. This is not a fairy tale, this is real data. And that's with real data that AI-based algorithms should work. And this is why public data sets with real data are so important, because nowadays we are advancing a lot, not us in particular, but old community, AI community is advancing a lot, but there is a problem. Usually people have very few real data to test their solutions, and this is a huge problem for the advancement of science. So, we have provided in scope of working group and the task force of IEEE PES some data sets that comes from real data, which are public, and everybody can go there to these links and use it. Please discuss with us then your results if you use this set, because it's very interesting to learn about the use you make of them. And of course, if you have the possibility to share some data, it's also very good that you do so, and you can do that also using the link I have in this slide. And finally, also if you want to validate and to experiment some of your algorithms, and they can be machine learning algorithms, optimization algorithms, or even some other types of algorithms, this platform that I have shown you is quite good for that. So if it fits in our interest, we have started several collaborations like this. Please contact us. We will be happy to analyze the possibility. And if it is interesting for both parts, we will collaborate on that. Thank you. So this is the end of my talk.